Hi all, subscribe to our channel on YouTube and click on the bell icon to get the latest updates. For course inquiries, visit our website www.gatelectures.com and don't forget to register and subscribe to the latest post section. In the last video, we gave you an introduction regarding what are the various delays that we face. Now in this video, we are going to use all the terminologies that we have studied to understand what are the flow control methods. Okay. And we'll start with a simple discussion of the simple flow control method, and then we'll move forward with the other different types of flow control methods that are available. Now you should know what is the simple flow control methods and what exactly is flow control. What exactly is flow control? So what is a flow control? Let us say this is the sender and this is the receiver. This is the transmission media between the sender and the receiver. Now, we are assuming that receiver is a very slow device and sender is a very fast device. It can be anything, right? It can be real world scenario. Now, sender is sending some data packets. There are so many different data packets that are arriving towards the receiver. Receiver received these data packets. Okay, so initially the data packets are sitting in the buffer. But the problem is, because a receiver is busy doing some other task, or maybe because the processing power of the receiver is very slow, receiver is not able to process all these data packets, and as a result, this entire buffer is full. This entire buffer is full. Buffer, or you can say the queue. So queue is also called as a buffer. Now, if this buffer is full, and there's one more new data packet that is coming, what will happen? This new data packet we cannot store inside the buffer, so this new data packet will be discarded. This new data packet will be discarded. In the same way, all the subsequent data packets that are coming, if the space is not available in the buffer, then all those subsequent data packets will be discarded. So what happened? This will be an entire loss of data. Loss of data is a huge loss, because sometimes you send very useful information, very critical information, and you cannot afford even a single data packet to get lost. So here, this loss of data is because the sender is not able to follow the receiver, or the receiver is not able to process the data, and sender is still sending at a very, very high pace, or sender is sending the data at a very fast pace, and the receiver is not able to take that much amount of data. Again, the network is going to follow. Network is going to be killed. So, to solve this issue, we created the various flow control methods. Flow control methods mean the sender should always follow the receiver in such a way that if the receiver is not able to take the data, if the receiver is not able to process the data, then sender should not send it. There should be a mechanism, there should be a way for the sender to know that the data packet is used by the receiver or it can be processed by the receiver. Now, just for an example, here, the first mechanism that we introduced is called as simple flow control method. Simple flow control method. And what is the simple flow control method? It says that the sender will send the data packet to the receiver. Then the receiver will take the data packet. It will process it. And after processing, the receiver will send acknowledgement to the sender. So then first sender send the data, receiver will take the data packet, it will process it, then the receiver will send the acknowledgement to the sender. And after sender received the acknowledgement, it means that the data packet is successfully sent. After sender received the acknowledgement from the receiver, then the sender can send the next data packet to the receiver. And again, it will wait for the acknowledgement to arrive from the receiver. And this kind of flow control methodology is called as simple flow control methods. And it is used, it was very, very simple because it does not put any extra burden onto the network. And this is the easiest method that we can use. Okay. Now, what will happen here? There's one more way of showing this exactly same thing. What is that way? That this is how I'm showing time. This is how I'm showing time. Okay. This is time at the sender side, and this is the time at the receiver side. So initially, if you have a data packet, then first of all, sender has to place the data packet onto the transmission media. Sender has to place the data packet onto the transmission media. Therefore, sender will take transmission time. And for simplicity purposes, I'm saying it is a transmission time of the sender, or you can say of the data packet D. So this is the time. So sender will take some time to transmit or to transmit the data packet onto the transmission media. So therefore, this time is called as transmission delay for the data. Transmission delay for the data. And as soon as the one bit of information, or you can say some bits of information, are placed onto the transmission media, they'll start traveling to the receiver. They'll start traveling to the receiver. For example, let us say the sender is putting the data, which is 110.1.1.0.1. It is sending this data to the receiver. Now, it will place the first bit of information, 10. Then, when this 10 will move forward, then the next 1 will come here. When these two will move forward, then the next 0 will come here, and so on. In the same way, when this sender has already transmitted the data, then this data will start traveling to the receiver side. So this is the first bit that sender has placed, so it will start traveling to the receiver side. And why there is a slant here? There is a slant because there is some time that is being consumed. So the first bit of information will take the same time as the last bit of information. All these bits of information will take exactly the same time, because that is a propagation delay. So this one bit of information will take time to transmit to the receiver. And this time, or you can say this time, both these times here, from here to here, and from here to here, both this time will be exactly the same. And this time is called as the propagation time, or you can say propagation time of data. Propagation time of data. Okay. Because as I told you, the propagation delay is actually time taken for one bit to travel from the sender to the receiver. So this will be the propagation time of that one bit of information. Now, here, after the receiver received this one bit of information, it will take that data packet and it will place the data packet onto this buffer. So the time taken for this data packet to stay in the buffer is called as a buffering delay, or you can say T buffer for data. T buffer for data. And after here, then it will be taken for processing. Then the receiver will process the data, and assuming that this is a T processing time for data. T processing time for data. After processing the data, receiver will say, yes, I received the data perfectly. Now, receiver will send an acknowledgement to the sender. Then the receiver will create an acknowledgement packet. And again, it has to send the acknowledgement packet back to the receiver. Therefore, again, there's a transmission time that will be utilized here. And this transmission time is for the acknowledgement. So again, the receiver is going to place one data packet here. And this data packet will take transmission time for acknowledgement, because this data packet is actually acknowledgement. Then this data packet will start traveling here and will consume some time for traveling, or you can say to send this information. Again, this is the same propagation time, or you can say it is T propagation time for acknowledgement. And after the sender will receive the acknowledgement will wait in the buffer, and then the acknowledgement will be processed. So again, there's a T buffering time and T processing time. Now, here, what is the total time taken to transmit one data packet? The total time taken to transmit one data packet will be equal to transmission time of data plus propagation time of data plus buffering time or T queuing delay for data plus T processing time for data plus transmission time for acknowledgement, plus propagation time for acknowledgement plus then we'll be having this queuing delay for acknowledgement and processing delay for acknowledgement. So T queuing for acknowledgement plus T processing for acknowledgement. So this is the total time that is taken. Now in this total time, we do not know what is the value of this T queuing for data, T queuing processing for data, T queuing for acknowledgement, and T processing for acknowledgement, because we generally assume these values as zero. Most of the cases we are going to assume it as zero because it is not given. But in any question, if these values are given, then you are going to take these values. Okay? So this is zero, this is zero, this is zero, and this is also zero. Therefore, what is the total time we get? Total time will be the transmission time of data plus propagation time of data plus transmission time of acknowledgement plus propagation time of acknowledgement. Okay? Now, you take this, that this value, propagation time of data will be equal to the propagation time of acknowledgement. These two values are equivalent. Why? If the speed of the network is same in both the directions, that means even if you send one bit of information from here to here or one bit of information from here to here, the distance is remaining constant and the speed is remaining constant. Therefore, the propagation time of data and the propagation time of acknowledgement both are same. So I can say T propagation for data will be equal to T propagation for acknowledgement. T propagation of data will be equal to the T propagation of acknowledgement. Therefore, instead of writing them as two separate values, I'm just going to say it is T propagation, or you can say TP. Hence, what is the total time that you are going to get? Total time. The total time is equal to TT for data plus TP for data plus TT for acknowledgement plus TP. Again, these are two TP values, so we can assume it as TT for data plus 2TP plus TT for acknowledgement plus TT for acknowledgement. Now, in general, this TT for acknowledgement, that is transmission time for acknowledgement, is very, very small. Why? Because acknowledgement just says that we have received a particular data packet. It is just an acknowledgement. Yes, we received. The size of the data packet that you are sending from the sender side can be very huge. The data packet can be 1500 bytes, it can be 1000 bytes, it can be 2 megabytes or 10 megabytes or 100 megabytes. The transmission that data is sending sender by the sender is can be very huge. It can be small, it can be huge. Its size is variable. But when I'm saying that acknowledgement, the acknowledgement is generally very small. Why? It just have to say yes, only yes, to the receiver that yes, we received the data. So it has to say only yes, right? So that is a very small value. Hence, this value is also zero. This value is also zero. Therefore, we get this value as transmission time for data plus 2 into propagation time. Plus 2 into propagation time. That is the total time we are going to get in case of simple flow control methods. Okay. Now, after getting this time, we need to identify what is the efficiency you are getting for the network. What is the efficiency? Okay. So, efficiency is, generally when we discuss about the efficiency of the network, efficiency is noted by this symbol. This is efficiency. Efficiency is generally what is the useful work divided by what is the total work. Useful work divided by total work. So here, the useful work is that we send one data packet. Okay, that is the only useful work. Because just to send one data packet perfectly, we have taken so many delays, and just to send this data packet perfectly, we are also sending the acknowledgement, right? So the useful work will be equal to the transmission time for data divided by transmission time plus 2 into propagation time. So in some questions, if these values are given, if this queuing delay, processing delay, queuing delay for acknowledgement, processing delay for acknowledgement, if these values are given in some question, then you are going to assume these values. We have to take these values here in case of denominator. You have to add them. But if those values are not given, then you are going to take this value. That this is a total work that is already done. You are going to take this work and then you will find this value of efficiency. So efficiency can be written as transmission time upon transmission time plus 2 into propagation time plus 2 TP. So that is called as the efficiency of the network. Okay. So in the next video, we'll discuss more about this simple flow control methods. We'll find out what is the effective bandwidth, what is the efficiency, and we'll solve some questions based on these values.